today I've got a video for you all about exporting assets for websites. Now, I consider the main goal when exporting an asset to go online is for the file size to be as small as possible without losing quality, because smaller file sizes mean faster loading time, and faster loading time means your users have a better experience. There are three main file types that I end up using when I'm exporting assets to be incorporated into the build of a site. In this video, I'm going to go through what those are, when you'd use each one, and how to compress them without losing quality. The first file type we're going to be talking about today is SVGs. SVG stands for Scalable Vector Graphics, as far as I'm aware, and it does what it says on the tin. It's a vector graphic, so it's made with points, and it's scalable, so you can bring it down really small or up really large, and it'll keep the same quality. If the asset you've created is a vector, it's likely that it'll be really suitable to use as an SVG on the site. For example, icons and logos, shapes work really well as SVGs. I personally wouldn't use SVGs for more complicated vector illustrations. I like to keep them simple. And with SVGs, the more points that your vector has, the larger the file will be. So that's something to keep in mind as well when you're creating your assets, is to make your vectors as simple as possible. What an SVG does is basically build the design in code. So the file you export is telling your web browser where the points should be and what colors should make up the shape. This also means that you can really easily change the color of an SVG with code without having to re-export a new file. So that's really handy. And these days, SVGs are the ideal way to put simple graphics like this up on a website. Because that way, no matter what screen resolution someone's using, or if they're on the desktop or their mobile, the image is still going to look sharp. I'm going to show you an example of exporting an SVG using my logo. So I've got it open in Sketch, and what I'm going to do is select all of the shapes that make up my logo, because you can see that each letter is an individual shape right now. And then I'm going to click Union up here. As you can see, it's ended up filling in the circles on my A's and E's and on this loopy M bit here, but that's easy to fix. I just select the two pieces and click Difference, and that'll cut it out again. Doing this is just good practice because it makes your SVG file smaller, so that's the reason I'm doing it. All right, once I've done that, I'm going to select that shape layer there and come down to Make Exportable in Sketch. I'm going to change this to SVG and save it in a folder. Remember I said with SVGs, you want to get them down as small as possible? This file is only 12 kilobytes right now, so it's pretty small already. It would be fine to go, but I want to show you a really handy SVG tool. It's called SVG OMG. And basically what you need to do is open up your SVG file. What this tool does is deletes any bits of unnecessary code in your SVG file. And you can see down here in this features list what it's actually doing if you care to take a look. But really all I care about is this little bit down here telling me how much of my file it's compressed. It's got it down to 2.49 kilobytes, which is amazing. And I can also click here to show the original. That way I can make sure that with its changes it's made and the, you know, pass it's done, it hasn't actually affected the look of my vector in any way, which it hasn't, so that's great. I'm just going to look at that download, and now I've got a smaller file. The next two file types I'm going to talk about, unlike SVGs and their vector scaling abilities, are bitmaps, and these are PNGs and JPEGs. Now, for both of these, you have to make sure that you're exporting your file at the right size, because if you export it too small and then try to blow it up in code later, it's going to look fuzzy and a bit terrible. So that's one thing to keep in mind, is to make sure that you're exporting your asset at the size that you want it to appear. These days with our retina screens, it's common practice to export a 1x version, which is just the exact dimensions that you want the image to appear at, and also a 2x version, which means basically double the size. The developer will then use a thing called media queries to look for when someone's using one of those high resolution screens and serve up that double size image instead. The image will still appear the same on the website, but it'll be much sharper for people on retina screens. I hope that makes sense, but I'm going to show you how to export for that anyway. Now, the main difference between JPEGs and PNGs is that PNGs can have a transparent background. This means that your exported asset could sit on any color background or even on top of another image, for example, without appearing like it's in a white box. SVGs have a transparent background as well, but there are definitely cases where a PNG is going to be more suitable than an SVG, like with this laptop on this product page I designed, for example. This image had bitmap elements, you know, it's got photographs in it, and it'd be a very complicated file if I exported this as an SVG, so a PNG was the right option here. So the rule of thumb for this is anything that you need to have a transparent background, but is too complicated to be a vector or includes photographic elements. PNGs are easy to export. I'll just show you with the same logo that I used last time. So select it, and instead of SVG, I'm going to click PNG. In Sketch, you can just click this little plus button, and it'll add a 2x version, or you can use this drop down to select it if you want. And it's good practice to put @2x at the end of the file name. Let's export that. And a really handy tool that I use for compressing PNGs is one called Image Optim. I've bumped up the settings that it comes like preloaded with for this. I've ticked enable lossy minification and dropped down the JPEG quality a bit, which just compresses it a bit more. Be careful with this because with JPEGs and PNGs especially, you can compress your image too much and it'll start to like break up and look a bit grainy and pixelated. So trial and error, see what's going to work best for your assets. All I have to do to use this is just drag my image files into Image Optim and it'll compress them. And as you can see, it's taken nearly 70% off both of those file sizes. So that's great. The great thing about Image Optim is it just resaves your file over it and replaces it. So that same file that you had is now just much smaller. Another tool I sometimes use for extra compression of PNGs is this website, tinypng.com. All you have to do is drag your files in here and it'll compress. And as you can see, this one's actually compressed those ones that already went through Image Optim even more, so that's great. I can probably bump up my settings in Image Optim, that means. The downside of using the site is that you then have to download the images and take them from your downloads folder and put them in your assets folder, so it's a bit of an extra step, which is why I prefer Image Optim. That brings us to our last file type, which is JPEGs, and I already talked a bit about them, but when you'd use a JPEG over a PNG is if it's a photo that is going like in a block anyway, or maybe if it's something that's going on a white background and you don't care about it being transparent, that could be a good case to use it. Generally, JPEGs can get smaller than PNGs because the file doesn't need to be thinking about that transparent background. So if your file doesn't need a transparent background, then generally go with a JPEG because it'll end up smaller. For this one, I'm going to show you exporting an image in Photoshop. The first thing that you want to do with JPEGs, and with PNGs really, but I see this problem more often with JPEGs, especially in blog images, is make sure that your image isn't bigger than it needs to be. So my image right now, if I go to image size up here, is 2000 pixels wide, which is really unnecessary. My blog, I think, is about 750 pixels wide is what the picture will end up being when it's displayed. So I'm just gonna make my image that wide instead. And 72 pixels per inch is a good resolution because that is screen resolution. I've got my quick keys down for exporting assets in Photoshop. I don't know if this is the way you're supposed to do it, but this is how I do it. I go Command, Alt, Shift, S, and opens up this Save for Web window. So up here, I'm gonna change it to JPEG. And it gives you a preview of what the file size is gonna be. What you can do is drag down this quality bar a little bit, because generally you can drop it down to maybe even 60 and it'll still be absolutely fine. Let's just zoom in a little bit and see. Nope, not affecting it much. So let's go with 50 for this. So already that's brought my file size down a lot. Let's save this out. And how I do a 2x image in Photoshop is I go to image size and I'll change this to percent and write 200. So it's going to make my file double the size. Now be aware you can only do this if your photo is in there as a smart object, which mine is, which means that it doesn't lose quality when you bring the file size up and down. Otherwise you should make sure you start your file at the 2x size. Image Optim is really good for compressing JPEGs, so let's drop these in here and see what it does. It's taken an extra 10% off both of those, so that's good. 100 kilobytes for a 2x full width blog image is pretty good. So those are my tips for exporting assets for web. I hope you found that useful and that now maybe the sites you design will load faster because your images are no bigger than they need to be. If you did find this video useful, please give it a thumbs up. And if you've got any questions at all, then please feel free to leave them down below in the comments. Thank you for watching, and I will see you next week for another design video. Bye!